Tonight, we bring you the second quarterfinal round of the CVC Law Debate Season 6. For this debate, two teams take on the culture of gun ownership and the use of these deadly weapons in the country. Is the current gun control law enough, or is it time for Congress to pass something with more teeth? I'm Mike Yoreta. Hello and welcome to Square Off, this CVC Law Debate. Private armed groups, indiscriminate firing during the new year, a shooting rampage in Cavite that leaves 8 people dead, and the Quezon incident where 13 men were killed at a checkpoint. These have put the spotlight on gun control in the country, or the lack of it. There are over 1.5 million licensed firearms in the country, and more than 500,000 loose firearms. Now, civil society groups are calling on the government to take bold measures to end gun violence.
Mr. President, we beg you to issue out. By your own authority, you can issue an executive order suspending the issuance of permit to carry.
Huwag gumawa ka ng krimen kahit saan, magpaputo ka lang, makikita yung basyo, matitrace sa'yo. You'll be more responsible.
Some call for a total gun ban. Others, tougher penalties on unlicensed firearms. And stricter screening of gun owners. Malacanang says while President Aquino is a gun enthusiast himself, it doesn't mean he's against a gun control law.
Magandang headline, total gun ban. Ito. Pero knee-jerk reaction, hindi ko gali mambola. Na maghanap tayo ng paraan na talagang masosolve yung issue at hindi nagpapakit lang.
So, is it time for lawmakers to review the current gun control law and give it more teeth? Arguing for the affirmative side is the CORE Hesu College.
From the gate city of the South, Digos, Davao del Sur. The next generation lawyers from CORE Hesu College.
I'm Ian DJ Henshineo and I'm from CORE Hesu College. I want to become a lawyer because lawyering for me is upholding the rights and searching for truth.
I'm Julius Frenzy Rizada. Ever since I consider myself as a social activist, I'm particularly interested on social impact of environmental degradation. And I think that I can better contribute suggestions or ideas if I have a legal mind.
I'm Diana Jane Sorongan from CORE Hesu College. Lawyering for me is integrating legal principles with the principles of the journey in life. We will definitely win this debate because we have made the best out of it. It is not just about winning, but we've learned that in the journey, you can never lose. You can only win and you can also top it.
Team CORE Hesu College. Dedicated, passionate, determined.
Taking on the negative side is the Siliman University.
From the city of gentle people, Dumaguete, the contenders from Siliman University.
I am Micah Stefan de Guerra. As a Siliman student, our motto is law with a conscience. And so lawyering for us is being a social advocate for justice as well as being excellent as an advocate of the law.
My name is Rochelle Reyalu. I came to realize that lawyering for me is such a humbling profession because you get to impart to others what you learn as you learn it.
I'm Kenny Melody Hatingoy. Lawyering for me is interpreting the laws and applying these interpretations based on my own principles in life. It's not really for us to determine who'll win, but I think we've prepared quite enough.
Team Siliman University, dedicated, driven, passionate.
Now let's meet our distinguished judges. First off, we have attorney Brian Dennis Tiohanko, a lecturer at the UP College of Law. Next, we have attorney Christopher James Purisima, a senior associate at the CVC law firm. And presiding as our chief adjudicator this evening is Judge Marjorie Uyenko Nolasco from RTC Branch 83 in Tanawan City, Batangas. The word war begins when Square Off the CVC Law Debates returns. Please stay tuned. Format. The debate is between two sides, the affirmative and the negative, with three members each. Each debater from the affirmative side argues either the necessity, beneficiality, or the practicability of the proposition, while the counterpart debaters on the negative side oppose these arguments. Each debater is given 4 minutes to deliver a constructive speech and rebut the previous argument. Each debater is given 2 minutes to interpolate or cross-examine the opposing debater. Only categorical questions may be asked. Each of the three judges may ask one question of each speaker within that speaker's time limit. The chief adjudicator rules in the event of ties, objections, or contestations. The judge's total scores determine the best speaker and the winning team. Tonight's proposition, let it be resolved that Congress should pass a law providing for stricter gun control. Starting off for the affirmative side is Ian. Ian, you have 4 minutes to argue why Congress must pass a gun control law with more teeth.
Good evening, Your Honors. We need to step forward. Pursuant to our burden of definition, we, the affirmative side, submit that the definition of the stricter gun control as an amendment of the provisions of the PD 1866 as amended and passing Senate Bill 2993, which is proposed by Senator Pampilio Lacson, to include specific requirements for gun ownership and licensing, which includes strict background control and psychological profile, specific limitation to the number of guns that an individual can own, and lastly, imposition of higher penalties. At the same time, stronger monitoring mechanisms on gun manufacturing and gun importation. There is a necessity to amend PD 1866 as amended for the following reasons. First, the present law is insufficient in addressing the rising gun-related criminality. Recent crimes such as the Maguindanao massacre, which claimed 58 innocent lives. At the same time, the unfortunate story of Stephanie Nicole Ella and the 90-minute rampage in Cavite, claiming 8 lives, are products of an insufficient gun control policy. According to gunpolicy.org, in 2009, there are an estimated 1.2 million loose and unlicensed firearms. In 2004 to 2009, 97% of the gun-related crimes are committed using loose firearms. In 2009, there were 4,711 incidents, and in 2010, 5,779 incidents, and take note of the number, these are rising. This made the Philippines the 10th in gun homicide rates worldwide. In the case of Chavez versus Romul, it was ruled that all the property in the state is held subject to the general regulations of the state, necessary to the common good and general welfare. U.S. Jurisprudence, State versus Rims, it was held that the legislature may regulate the right to bear arms in a manner conducive to the public peace. Implementation of the present law is actually not a problem because according to the annual report of the PNP in 2011, the implementation of PD 1866 is one of the successful. But at the same time, though it's successful, the gun-related crimes increases yearly. To illustrate, when it comes to the penalty, illegal gun manufacture as it stands now under PD 1866 as amended by 8294, it is imposed with a penalty below 6 years, which means that the violator can go for probation. We propose under Senate Bill 2993 that the illegal gun manufacturing and smuggling must be punished with reclusion perpetua. For the second argument, there is a need for stable law that is not dependent on mere executive guidelines to provide for specific limitation on gun ownership and licensing and stricter penalties. The problem with the status quo is that it is inconsistent, brought about by the insufficiency of the law. Depending on the president of the country or the chief the PNP. The limit to the number of guns that an individual can own changes as often as the leader changes. In 2008, pursuant to Special Order No. 13, a private individual can own a single one short gun. But in 2010, pursuant to PNP Memorandum Circular Number 2010-008, an individual may own an unlimited number of guns. This is totally a manifestation that the law as it is inconsistent. Therefore, there is a need to control the manufacture proliferation of unlawful guns and to curtail gun-related crimes. To do this, we need to have a law that sets specific standards and provides stricter penalties. Thus, the affirmative side submit that the present law must be amended. Thank you, Your Honors.
Okay, Rochelle, 2 minutes to cross-examine Ian.
Do you have a legal definition of gun control?
The gun control as we propose, according to SB
2993. Does Philippine law and jurisprudence provide a legal definition for gun control?
Precisely the point why we should pass such one.
Does not gun control refer to the manufacturing, dealing, acquisition, possession, and disposition of firearms?
Which is actually part of our proposal, Ms.
Are you unaware that in the Philippines, most gun-related crimes are committed using unlicensed loose firearms?
Which I was cited in my statistics.
And
yes.
Are you unaware that last October 2012, the number of loose firearms were lessened from 600,000 to 175?
But still, the gun-related violence increases.
Can you say that the direct and immediate goal of your proposal is to reduce the number of guns in the hands of private individuals?
Not but to filter the qualified ones.
Are you
qualified.
Aware that for a penalty over 15,000 pesos is not included in probation law?
Probation law, but it's included in the present law.
Which is more efficient? Is it the law or the memorandum circular that will prevail? Is it the law or the memorandum circular that will prevail?
And of course, it's the law.
Are you aware that there is a limitation in the law of only one long and one short firearm?
The present law as now gives an unlimited number of guns that a private...
Mr. Speaker, are you aware that the criminals are prone to do crimes in areas considered as gun-free zones, such as our schools, malls, and...
Precisely the reason why we should pass a stricter gun control law. Yes, of course. Precisely the reason why we're pushing for it. Yes.
Okay, Mr. Speaker,
Time's up, Rochelle. 4 minutes now to rebut Ian and argue why Congress need not pass a stricter gun control law.
Honored judges, respected opponents, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. At the outset, we would like to express that this is not strictly a legal debate. Real lives are at stake and real emotions fuel this discussion. The response of the negative side will be twofold. First, we will tell you that there is a difference between gun control and the prosecution for violations of firearm laws. Second, we will discuss how stricter gun control is not the solution to gun violence, rather it is efficient implementation of the law. That is the key because our firearm laws are adequate to address these problems. The difference between gun control and prosecuting gun violence is that the former is a technical term commonly used to refer to the legal and procedural acquisition of firearms without covering the means of prosecuting gun-related crimes. In the Philippine law and jurisprudence, we already have a strict gun control law represented by PD 1866 as amended, but our means of prosecuting gun offenses remain as various rules and regulations prescribed by the Philippine National Police. This distinction is important because while legislation for stricter gun control is not necessary, legislation regarding efficient prosecution for gun offenses is. There are at least two reasons for this. First, most gun crimes in the Philippines, such as the well-known recent cases in Cavite and of Nicol, are committed using unlicensed firearms. But the proposal coming from the affirmative side does not address this problem. Second, as regards gun control, the law regulating legal and responsible gun ownership does not need to be made more stringent because It will only disable law-abiding citizens to protect themselves using legal firearms. Which is why the solutions being forwarded by the negative side do not necessitate a stricter gun control, but which shall include strengthening interagency cooperation to closely monitor illegal manufacturers of firearms, as well as policing the ports of entry for smuggled firearms in the archipelago. In addition to these executive actions, some non-gun control legislations must be made to support and sustain the overall effort to efficiently implement prosecution of gun offenses, such as augmenting the budget of the PNP to accommodate better facilities and modern technologies in aid of their work, increasing penalties for violations of firearms law, inapplicability of plea bargaining, intensifying police visibility in the local, regional, and national level, promoting firearms amnesty, and lastly, to designate special courts and prosecutors to exclusively hear and adjudicate cases involving gun-related offenses to ascertain and expedite legislation. With these, the negative side respectfully opens its case.
All right, Ian, 2 minutes now to cross-examine Rochelle.
Hi, Rochelle.
I'm going to be Ian.
Okay, is it your contention that the existing law is sufficient so that there should be no amendment?
It is our contention yes, that no, the existing law is adequate.
Okay, so are you aware that under the existing law, specifically RA 8294, illegal manufacture of low-powered firearms is punishable only 4 years and 2 months and 1 day to 6 years?
Yes.
So it means that you can apply for probation, right?
Yes.
So therefore, are you aware that a person who sells or transports illegal drugs is not eligible to post bail as a matter of right? However, a person who manufactured high-powered guns can still post bail as a matter of right.
Hence the legislation of prosecution,
okay.
Prosecuting laws.
A person who is a victim of drug can be rehabilitated.
Yes.
Yes. But a person who is killed with a loose gun, can he be rehabilitated?
If he survives, yes.
He's dead already, Ms. Speaker, so he cannot be rehabilitated.
Not in all instances.
Are you aware that under 2008, under EO-194 and now under PNP guideline number 11-2005, it does not limit the number of guns that can be licensed as to ownership with a certain person?
Yes, but what...
Okay, therefore, so are you telling me that a father can own 20 guns, a mother can own 20 guns, a sister can own 20 guns?
No, because the law will
so
prevail
therefore,
and not a memorandum circular.
So therefore, the family can own as much as 100 guns?
No.
Okay. So, are you aware that EO-194, which allowed unlimited guns to individual, was passed by Estrada in 2008? Not Estrada, actually. Okay, so are you aware that 1 year thereafter, in 2009, the Maguindanao massacre happened? Okay. Don't you see even a little correlation between the rule allowing a person to own multiple guns with that massacre?
No, there is no causal connection.
Was there an approval on the part of Apatuan that he is allowed to own a lot of number of guns?
No.
Yes, it was allowed. Okay.
Yes, and it is part of the
prosecution. You would agree with me that there is a need for the government to assess the psychiatric condition of a person before he is allowed to have a license.
Yes.
Okay, time's up, guys. Second affirmative speaker, Yan. 4 minutes now to argue the benefit of a stricter gun control law.
Good evening, Your Honors, ladies and gentlemen. As the second speaker, let me address one of the key points of the first speaker in the negative side. Actually, Madam Speaker, implementation of the present law is not the basic problem because according to the PNP, which reported in their annual report of 2011, the implementation of PD 1866 is a success. But still, the gun-related crimes increases yearly. Now, is it really beneficial to pass a law for stricter gun control? We say in the affirmative yes, because first, stringent gun control and strict enforcement will ultimately decrease crime rates. And second, it will promote responsible gun ownership, which is in consonance with international laws. Now, to my first point, according to a study of United Nations on stricter gun control, countries with stricter gun control law and stricter enforcement have successfully reduced firearm-related violence, such as expanded firearm prohibitions to persons convicted of crimes of violence, which improved in disarming offenders to reduce crimes. As in the case of Australia, for 10 years, the Australian government has been implementing stricter gun control law, which resulted to a 59% drop on firearm-related crimes. And in Milwaukee, where gun stores sell firearms that were used in crimes, the government imposed higher penalties. And within 1 year, these illicit gun sale transactions dropped by 43%. Where firearms are available, coupled with stricter gun control law and stricter enforcement, gun sellers reduced diversions of guns to criminals, which in turn lowered crime rates. Therefore, better, stricter gun control laws added with the effective enforcement of the law would help the government. However, in a PNP report from 2004 to 2009, Philippines has 2.8 million firearms that were used to commit crimes. Moreover, 96% of these crimes, or a total of 2.5 million, are loose firearms or unlicensed. However, very few of these have been acted upon with the existing law. Therefore, stricter gun control law and stricter enforcement is a response to the existing inefficiency of the law. We need a stricter gun control law that completely closes opportunity for unqualified persons, criminals, and illegal manufacturers to acquire, possess, and sell guns. This is the benefit of stricter gun control law. On our second point, stricter gun control law, which provides strict background checks and psychiatric profile tests upon purchasers, will ultimately advance a more responsible gun ownership and thereby advancing the legal mandates under international laws. Another study by the UN which suggests that responsible gun ownership could save 25 to 75 lives for every life lost to a gun. It prevents injuries to a greater number of people. And according to a study in Yale University, that for those countries who have adopted this kind of scheme for over 10 years, there was this increase in responsible gun ownership, and it avoidably 1,500 murders were avoided, 4,100 rapes, and 60,000 aggravated assaults annually.
Are you aware that in District of Columbia versus Heller, the U.S. Supreme Court found that there was no actual causation, or that strict gun control laws was not able to mitigate gun-related problems in the District of Columbia for 60 years and in other states that were neighboring it?
Yes, sir, but in that case, that is a developed country, and I guess the gun politics and the environment upon which the policy had been implemented varies greatly to that of the Philippines, which is a developing country. Now to continue. Yes, sir.
If your principal point or one of your principal points is deterrence, is it not better to strengthen
enforcement? Sorry, Attorney Purisima, she has no time to answer that question. KM now, 2 minutes to cross-examine Yan.
Good evening, Yan.
Good evening, Ken.
First question. Yes or no, are you aware of PNP Memorandum Circular dated December 7, 2012? Are you aware of that circular, ma'am?
To my answer, yes
or no, please. Okay, yes or no. Since you know this about the circular, you also have come across the fact that in that circular, ma'am, that the number of unlicensed firearms was reduced from 600,000 to 175,000 since 2009. That was just barely 3 years. Are you aware of that?
I am aware, but the loose firearms are still increasing from 2000 to 2009. So we should see the trending and the correlation.
Yes or no, ma'am. Good. Then are you aware also that there is absolutely no legislation passed between 1866 and the amendments and that decrease? There was no legislation passed between that day, but still there was decrease of number in unlicensed firearms. And the crimes that was committed was done by those unlicensed firearms and not other licensed firearms, which your law seeks to pass.
Actually, precisely our point that there should be a law to be passed on stricter gun control.
Precisely,
and you
our,
might be referring on
point,
the change
ma'am.
Of the government from Marcos
no, ma'am.
To,
there's no
to
difference.
Aquino, wherein the faith of the government was being
yes or no, ma'am.
By the people.
Okay, next question to the substantial side now.
Okay,
are you aware of your right to self-defense?
Yes, of course.
Okay, then if you are you unaware that self-defense can be committed by any method? For example, a gun, a bolo, or your gun, your bolo, or your knife. Are you aware of that? Yes, of course. But again, it's the most effective means to
therefore,
self-defense.
By committing that crime, as long as you have the mens rea, the method becomes immaterial. It becomes impertinent and irrelevant, right?
It doesn't
follow. No, it does. All right. So how do you commit, therefore, self-defense? By biting each other?
Precisely why we should.
No, the point.
Acquire
next
gun,
ma'am,
but we are not advocating.
Next, true or false?
All right, ladies, time's up. Cam, 4 minutes now to rebut Yan and argue why it would not be beneficial to have a stricter gun control law.
Okay. Honored judges, respected opponents, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My discussion on the beneficiality, actually, of the proposition will likewise come into two main points. First, that the proposal coming from the affirmative wing will not help solve the problem and will rather worsen it, hence it is not beneficial. Second, that it is the negative side which will propose a more effective and a more comprehensive strategy of combating gun violence in the Philippines committed by unlicensed firearms. Hence, the value of beneficiality is found in our side and not theirs. On the first point, ma'am, the main reason for law-abiding citizens actually to get guns is for self-defense. And with more stringent requirements, ladies and gentlemen, in the law proposed by the affirmative side, it will only make guns less accessible to those seeking to legally acquire the same, while those already possessing illegal firearms will simply continue to own them. What this produces, therefore, ladies and gentlemen, is a situation where those with legitimate rights, such as the right to self-defense, will be disarmed and left at the mercy of those possessing illegal firearms to commit certain crimes. There is definitely no connection between restricting the licensing of firearms and the commission of crimes using unlicensed firearms. Hence, there is absolutely no compelling state interest for the Congress to legislate stricter gun laws at the expense of the legitimate right of law-abiding gun holders to self-defense. And self-defense will all be more paramount because the imposition of stricter gun law, gun violence ironically will go up. Now, let us cite some of the statistics that they've been citing. In Boston, for example, where gun control is at its most stringent, and I'm sure everyone knows about this, that gun violence is also at its highest all over the United States. That was in Boston. Mass shootings ironically occur in areas where the strictest ban in guns, for example, in malls and in schools. The Batman shooting, for example, you know that? In all the 7 theaters there, only this. Yes, sir.
Yes. Does the failure of our Constitution to adopt the right to bear arms, which is present in the U.S. Constitution, despite our adoption of the other rights in the U.S. Constitution, does that mean that we do not hold the right to bear arms as a privileged right in our country?
Maybe it was not explicitly written that the right to bear arms in our Constitution, but the fact that we have self-defense and the fact that we have Article 2, Section 3 and 5 of our Constitution, that is enough for us. And I don't think we do not agree to that proposition that there is a lack of thing in our Constitution. So how about proceeding, sir? How about in Florida, for example, where gun laws are less stricter, gun violence actually was almost zero. On the second point, it is important to recognize that the proposition of the affirmative wing prescribes only one mode and means of curbing gun violence. We think that this is myopic and even unresponsive to the needs and realities of this debate. The negative wing counters criminality perpetrated by unlicensed firearms with a multi-pronged approach, as my first speaker has already elaborated, which covers areas such as prosecute, ways to prosecute, certainty of conviction, and creating gun laws. And you do not need further, you need legislation and the executive side of it and not on gun control per se. We strengthen the implementation of mechanisms that preempt and prosecute the commission of gun violence, whether it be through unlicensed or even licensed firearms, as was elaborated again by our first speaker.
Okay, Cam, time's up. Yan, 2 minutes now to cross-examine her.
Hi, Ken.
Hello.
Would you agree with me that the qualification that the law requires is only 21 years old and a Filipino citizen?
I don't agree with that.
Yes, it's
you
written.
Should agree with
it's
that
written
because
there.
It is written in the law.
And do you agree that with the current PNP guidelines, the chief of the PNP may further provide guidelines of such qualification?
Yes, because they're the one who knows these criminals. They're
yes,
there.
Of course. Therefore, that these laws can easily be changed with the change of the chief PNP according to his discretion. Therefore, you really have to agree with me that
yes,
these guidelines
that
are
that.
Just guidelines and not laws.
There's nothing wrong with that. Those are guidelines. And like I said, they're the ones who are there. They're the one who can see who can really commit
okay.
this crime.
So, do you also agree with me that the recent PNP guidelines are lacking of psychiatric tests and psychological background?
Yes, but therefore
executive
you
therefore
can handle
the
that.
More that the government
executive
should pass
can
a
handle
law
that and not
for
legislation
for gun control
executive.
Which also qualifies that this qualification should also be passed into law.
We do not
so
agree that
these
that a law
qualifications will not be changed with regards to the chief PNP.
We do not agree that a law is required, but yes, that can be changed.
The qualification is
stage.
Insufficient, therefore you are submitting to me that such guidelines
the
can be changed
executive
because of the
qualifications
issued by the chief PNP. Yes or no?
That would be negative.
It is actually a yes.
That's your opinion.
Would you also agree with me that the existing rules allow the chief of the PNP to set the limit as to the number of firearms an individual may possess?
They can, yes.
Yes.
At the executive level.
No, why?
But given at the legislative,
no,
that would matter.
We are talking about the chief PNP. This
yes,
is a special agency. This is not an executive act.
That's
yes or no?
It's
yes.
an executive act.
A chief
they
PNP.
Can.
Okay, break it up, ladies. Let's give the floor to our third affirmative speaker, JR. You have 4 minutes to argue the practicability of implementing stricter gun control laws.
Good evening, Your Honors. The argument of the other side is basically summarized into this point that you can impose, you can change anything except PD 1866 as amended. But what we are saying is that this is not a mutually exclusive solution that we are presenting. The problem with their proposition is that they seem to conclude that we are for total gun ban and they fail to cite specific problem with our proposal, which is actually a big problem in this debate. Interposing stricter gun control, as already discussed, is practicable because first, it is constitutional and legal. Second, it can be enforced because there are government agencies specifically established to enforce laws on gun control. And third, the proposal enjoys the wide support because it is based on strong public demand, which is now a global trend. First, it is constitutional and legal. The basic premise is that the right of individuals to bear arms is not absolute, but is subject to regulation as held in the case of Chavez versus Romulo. In that case, the court explained that the possession of firearms by the citizens in the Philippines is the exception and not the general rule. The right to bear arms is a mere statutory privilege, not a constitutional right. Being a mere statutory privilege, it can be regulated by enacting laws, rules, and regulations in order for such laws to protect public security. Yes, Your Honors.
Does the right to life include the right to self-preservation or the right to self-defense, especially at one's home, using the best means accessible?
Yes, Your Honor. And that is why we are not proposing for a total gun ban, but we are proposing for a balancing act of what would be a better solution to this problem. Second point, Your Honor, is that stricter gun control measures can be implemented because we have existing institutional mechanisms to implement such measures, specifically through the Firearms and Explosive Division of the PNP, which is actually pursuant to Section 42 RA of RA 6975, which is the primary agency of the government mandated to administer, enforce, and implement firearm laws, rules, and regulations. Also, it carries out corresponding information dissemination whenever IRRs are being amended. Moreover, our proposal is not only feasible, it will also improve existing enforcement mechanisms by removing ambiguities resulting from different policies carried out because of different directives from the President and the Chief of the PNP, which the status quo allows. Thirdly, the proposal is based on strong public demand for the government to curb the increase of crime rate due to proliferation of loose firearms. In a survey, 83% of adult population of Filipinos called for a more restrictive gun policy. In fact, this reflects the worldwide trend to respond to Claymore for more restrictive gun laws to curb criminality and terrorism. Yes, Your Honor.
Since you are arguing regarding the practicability of having a new law for stricter gun control, did you take into consideration the budgetary aspect, like the funding and the finances that this will, that the new law will involve once it is passed and implemented?
Yes, Your Honor. This is actually very feasible because we're actually just changing the limitations and the qualifications by which this can be enforced. And again, we have already an existing agency to enforce these amendments, which is the Foreign FED of the PNP. Yeah, may I continue, Your Honor? Other countries, Asian countries, European countries, and even the United States, where the right to bear firearms is a constitutional right, no less than President Obama proposed for amendments.
Okay, time's up, JR. Micah, 2 minutes now to cross-examine him.
May gabi, Kuya Julius.
May gabi, but Mike.
Do you have a legal definition for gun control?
Yes, we have legal definition as in our based on our proposal.
In Senate Bill 2992, correct?
Yes, and it is subject
to
improvement.
Is this not the same as found in PD 1866, referring to the manufacture, acquisition, and possession of firearms?
With improvements. We are proposing
that,
for
correct?
Improvement, yes.
Now, are you aware of the U.S. Gun Control Act of 1968?
I'm not aware.
Are you aware of the U.S. Violent Crime Control and Law Enforcement Act of 1994?
U.S.? No, I'm not aware.
Are you unaware then that there is a legal distinction between gun control and prosecuting gun crimes?
In the U.S.?
In jurisprudence around
the
world.
It is better that this will be provided using our proposal.
But you agree that there's no established definition of the gun control in the Philippines.
Yes,
and therefore,
the
we are left with
yes.
what is already established,
yes,
correct?
Yes, that's a problem.
Okay,
Mike.
Moving on. Does your proposal not limit its application to licensed owners?
No, because it's deemed to be a comprehensive solution that we try to propose.
But how is it possible then that you limit the number of licensed owners and then you go after, through that proposal, the unlicensed guns out there?
No, as long as you are qualified, you can have the permit. So we are promoting for responsible gun ownership here.
Okay, moving on. You do not propose a total gun ban, correct?
Yes.
But you concede that there is a value to self-defense.
Of course.
Will your proposal not reduce the number of guns available to those who want to protect themselves that way?
No, that is contrary to our intention about the law that we're trying to propose here.
But then, are you aware that most gun crimes in the Philippines are committed using unlicensed firearms, such as in Cavite and with Nicole?
Yes, with more reason that you have to support our proposal.
All right, time's up, guys. Micah, 4 minutes now to rebut JR and advance your argument on why it would not be practicable to have stricter gun control laws.
Honored judges, respected opponents, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Your honors, you have seen in this debate some points of agreement between both sides. First, that gun violence is a problem. Second, that a solution must be found. Third, that implementation must be strengthened. And fourth, that the right to own firearms can be regulated pursuant to Chavez versus Romulo. We do not doubt the purity of the intentions of affirmative side in this debate in forwarding their proposal. The only issue in contest, therefore, and upon which this debate must stand or fall, is who was best able to present the better solution at the end of the day. Let me begin with a synthesis of the significant contributions of both sides. We see that there seems to be some agreement as to between both sides, between implementation and enforcement. I don't think affirmative side would disagree that we want to increase penalties, that we don't want it to be subject to probation, that we want more money to the PNP to improve technologies and whatever and what have you to police the manufacture and distribution of these arms. Where we differ then, and this is where Julius asked for a problem with the proposal, which we already discussed, is what's the harm of a stricter gun control? And here it is, if it wasn't clear or it wasn't received well by the affirmative side, it was actually already discussed by my previous speaker. What happens if you increase gun control or you make it more stringent? The problem is you reduce the ability of licensed, qualified, responsible gun owners to get these guns without addressing the problem of unlicensed firearms. There's no causal link between making it more stringent for legal and licensed owners and getting more unlicensed firearms from the market. If anything, it will make things more dangerous in that the responsible ones are now disarmed while you allow those holding unlicensed and illegal firearms to continue holding them, and with lesser ability for the public and the police to respond effectively. Which is why in my previous speaker, we've already established that in the United States, where you increase gun controls, you have worse and more frequent incidences of gun crimes. In Florida, where it is the least stringent, you actually have the least amount of gun crimes as well. And the deterrent effect here is not just in government holding guns, but in the awareness that if you're in a neighborhood that owns guns, you do not know which particular house can actually shoot you should you try to trespass or steal something in that regard. Yes, Your Honor.
Counsel, regardless of the issue of causation or deterrence, is it not the obligation of the state to protect its citizens considering the sophistication of criminal activities?
Indeed, Your Honor, and we thank you for that point. In Article 2, Section 3 and 5 of the Constitution, it provides that it is the primary duty of the state to protect its citizens, but that does not, of course, preclude the ability of the private individual, his or herself, to take necessary precautions in response to that, and also with the reality that a government cannot possibly protect each and every person every second of the day. Which is why part of our solution being proposed through our first speaker was to increase the budget for the PNP, hopefully to get more arms and hopefully to employ more policemen to increase government's ability to protect it, which is not feasible under a more stringent gun control act as proposed by affirmative side in this debate, Your Honors, because it has nothing to do with the actual acquisition, investigation, and prosecution for the commission of illegal possession and criminal acts perpetrated using unlicensed
firearms. Thank you, Micah. JR, 2 minutes now to cross-examine him.
Good evening, Micah.
Micah B.A. Julius.
Micah, are you aware that RA 8294, which amended PD 1866, was amended in last 1997?
Yes.
Are you aware that based on the study Gun Proliferation and Violence, which was published in 2012, in the study it said that from 1997 to 2004, there have been an increasing number of firearms, both licensed and unlicensed?
Yes, but there's no link.
You agree with me? Are you aware also that during the same period also, the crime gun-related violence also increased based on that study?
But making it more strict,
yes or no,
will not solve it.
Therefore, you must agree with me that the current law is not effective, and therefore you have to agree with our proposal that we need to amend it in order to consider all
gun
our
control
proposals
law
here.
Yes, gun prosecution,
I would like to continue. Are you aware that ASEAN and European countries except France, Netherlands, Switzerland, and even all of African states except South Africa all have heavily regulated gun ownership or even banned civilian gun ownership, according to a report of pro-gun organization?
But what is the link to the
Philippine
setting?
Are you aware of that? Are you aware of that?
Oh, there's no way to verify
that
statistic.
Are you aware also that almost all South American countries charge very high license fees so that it's almost impossible to own a gun?
Okay.
So therefore, you have to agree with me then that there is a worldwide phenomenon for a stricter gun control.
Definitely not worldwide, since you didn't mention the United States,
majority
Europe,
of the continents I've already mentioned. Are you saying then that
continents.
The rest of the world is wrong and now you are right?
I did not get the question. Sorry.
Because the world is all, this is a worldwide phenomenon. Won't you agree?
No.
That's why I'm saying that the rest of the world is wrong and you're saying that you are right.
But it could be the reverse, that you could be wrong.
Okay, time's up, guys. Thank you all very much. May we now invite both sides to cross the house as our judges tally the scores. Square Off, the CVC Law Debates will return after these messages. Now let's hear what our judges have to say about the performances of our two teams. Attorney Purisima, how did the affirmative side, the Cor Jesu College, do tonight?
Yeah, good evening again. Well, the issue of gun control is as much a sociological reality issue and legal policy issue as it is an issue of enforcement and application of the law. So I thank you for enlightening us on concrete examples, on the empiricals, on statistical data, because it would be disappointing if it would just be debated in abstraction. So thank you for that, and I appreciate all the work you've put in, and your arguments especially. So continue to do that, and congratulations.
And Attorney Tiohanko, what can you say about the negative side, the Siliman University?
First of all, congratulations to both sides for giving us an entertaining and an excellent debate. And for the negative side, I like the theory that they put forward, the distinction between gun control and efficient prosecution for a violation, the fact that they pointed out causation, and that they hinted to the right of self-defense, which in some countries is regarded as a natural right of liberal societies. And that I like the fact that they pointed out the harm of stricter gun control in depriving people of the opportunity for self-defense. The only comment that I have is that I felt there was a lack of empirical basis in some of the claims. I wish that it would have been strengthened by solid data on that part. But overall, it was a good performance.
We'll bring you the judges' results next. Please stay tuned. Square Off, the CVC Law Debates will return after these messages. Welcome back, and now for the results. Let's hear from our chief adjudicator, Judge Marjorie Uyenko Nolasco. Your Honor, who did the judges pick for best speaker?
Okay, before I announce the winner for the best speaker as well as the winning team, I would like to congratulate both teams who came all the way from the provinces to be here. I was impressed by the performance of both groups, so congratulations, future Pañeros and Pañeras. Now for the best speaker is the first speaker for the affirmative side, Ian Genshaneo. Congratulations, Ian.
And so, who won tonight's debate, Your Honor?
It was a close fight again. Every time I judge, it's always a close fight. So, the winning team for tonight is the affirmative side for Jesu College.
Congratulations to Cor Jesu College for winning the second quarterfinal round of Square Off the CVC Law Debate Season 6. Next week, law students from Palawan State University and the University of San Carlos will battle it out in the third round of the quarterfinals. I'm Mike Yoreta. Thank you for watching.